Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be talking about what a PFR is. In particular, we'll talk about how they work, what they're commonly used for, and develop an equation for them. PFR stands for plug flow reactor. Much like CSTRs, PFRs also operate continuously, meaning that they are a steady state process. Well, what does a PFR look like? PFRs are commonly a long coiling tube in which there is a reacting component. Commonly, we also have a heating or cooling jacket around the reactor. This is to manage the temperature of the system. Which of the two jackets is used will depend on the reaction occurring and whether it is exothermic or endothermic. In these types of reactors, there is just one inlet and one outlet. And as the reactant works its way through the reactor, it is constantly being converted to the product of interest. There are many ideal assumptions with the plug flow reactors. So let's go through these now. Firstly, we assume that there's no axial mixing in the reactor. This means that we are assuming that point B here has no interaction with points A and C. Secondly, and the reason for our first assumption, is that we assume perfect radial mixing, which means if we were to take a cross-section of any point in our ideal plug flow reactor, then we would have the exact same composition and temperature throughout that entire cross-section. Therefore, because of these two assumptions, and with how the plug flow reactor is set up, that we track the changes in our fluid's composition as a function of distance through the plug flow reactor rather than time like we did with our other reactors like the batch, semi-batch, and CSTR. So, if we were operating our plug flow reactor here at steady state, then 1 meter into our reactor should always, in theory, give the same composition whether we test that composition now or in an hour from now. So, lastly, because our plug flow reactor is a steady state reactor, that means that when operating, we continuously will be feeding it reactants and removing products at the same time. The idea here being that new reactants enter our tank, stay reacting for a certain amount of time, called our residence time, and then leave the reactor once the reactants have all become products. I should note that when we are talking about the residence time of a PFR, it is slightly different than a CSTR's residence time. In a CSTR, the residence time is a distribution based on statistics, and that is why it looks like a bell curve. It is based on the average time an average particle spends in the CSTR. Whereas in a plug flow reactor, we just have a single residence time, as we are assuming that the fluid is continually and always moving forward at a constant rate. This is why we call it a plug flow reactor. You can imagine this little plug shape here acting as an infinitesimally small CSTR. And by stringing our infinite amount of CSTRs together, we get a plug flow reactor. Some advantages to PFRs are that they are great for gas phase and liquid phase reactions. Additionally, we can experience fast reaction times in a plug flow reactor, and therefore we have high levels of conversion for the volume needed, unlike CSTRs, which we talked about in the last video. Operating continuously is great for industrial scale-up of a reactor, versus things like a batch or a semi-batch reactor, which are harder to scale up. We can also achieve higher temperatures in PFRs, which is something necessary for some reactions. Another benefit is that we have lower labor costs, as the reactor will mostly be running itself as it is steady state. However, because it is just a long tube, sometimes cleaning the PFRs can be a challenge to make sure that it is properly sanitized upon shutdown. Also, shutdown can sometimes be expensive depending on what is being reacted and the size of the PFR. In terms of industrial use, these types of reactors are commonly found in the petrochemical, pharmaceutical, and several other chemical-based industries. Okay, so now that we have an understanding of what a plug flow reactor is, what they look like, and how they work, let's talk about the general mole balance around a PFR. We introduced the mole balance in a previous video, and I will leave a link in the description below for you to check out that video in case you missed it. So, I've just written the general mole balance here, and we can eliminate any terms that we don't need. So, we are studying one constant area of our plug flow reactor over time. So just remember that we mentioned earlier that the inlet and the outlet to the reactor must always be equal, otherwise we would not have a steady state. So, this means that our accumulation term will be zero, and this will always be the case for a steady state system. So, we just have the moles of component A coming into our system minus the moles of component A leaving our system, plus the amount of moles of A generated within our reactor, minus the amount of moles consumed within the reactor. So this term here could be the generation of A or the consumption of A, or both, depending on what part component A plays in the reaction. Just note that GA here stands for the generation or consumption of component A. Therefore, it is equal to the rate of formation, in the terms of generation, or rate of consumption, in the terms of consumption, times the volume within our reactor. We'll talk more about this in coming videos, though. Because we are only studying one chunk in our plug flow reactor here, we can make this control volume infinitesimally small, and we get the following. Thank you for checking out this video, and I hope it helped your fundamental understanding of what plug flow reactors are and how they operate. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our Patreon page to support the channel. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below and I will do my best to address your concerns.